Okay, so I'm sorry for the late beginning. As you can't see right here, but as you can see here on the left bottom, it's 2:09 right now in my country. So I was in the speaker room and suddenly I got a phone call like, hey, where are you? So I ran here. This is a session about PowerShell. Who is a Linux person here? You are in the right room because PowerShell now runs on Linux. So before we get a discussion about, hey, should I use PowerShell or Bash or Python, or my philosophy is whatever floats your boat. If you're from a Linux world, then learning PowerShell instead of using Bash on Windows sounds a little bit like, why? You already have Bash. And it can accomplish your goal, probably. So I'm a very practical guy. If you are good in Python or in Bash, use it. If you're from a Windows world, PowerShell is probably easier to learn. So the big difference between Bash or Python and PowerShell is basically objects. In Windows, everything is an object. Even a basic text is an object. It's a string and it has methods like to upper, to lower, case, etc. In Linux, everything is text. Like the whole operating system is based around the concept everything is text or file, or etc. That's the big difference. So over the years I gathered quite a few tips and tricks. That's why I created this session. And last week I changed it because I've done it more than 20. because it's I've done it more than 20 times. And I got a little bit bored by it, so I took out some sessions. I still put it in the code, so I'll share the code after the session. You can look at it. But I used a use case of a script that my customer was using. They were using Nessus. Does anybody know what Nessus is? Nessus? It's like a tool that scans your environment and tells you, are you compliant and stuff like that. So it gives you output, a whole bunch of XML files. And we've written a few scripts to go parse through all those files and give us a pretty decent report, like how bad is our environment currently in? Like how many vulnerabilities do we have? How many warnings, errors, etc. They wrote the script just by copy pasting from the internet. And it took, in that data set, about 2.5 hours to run. And that was like really, really bad. Then I sat together with one of the admins for 2 weeks. Every day we did a little bit. And after we were done, it was able to run in 22 minutes. So a lot better. And at the end of the session, last 15 minutes, I'll walk through what steps we took. So that's me. My name is Jeff Wouters. I'm an MVP, Microsoft trainer, and all the trainings I give are PowerShell or PowerShell related. So that's it. And I started my own company with the main focus of gathering PowerShell people, PowerShell oriented people from the Microsoft world. So admins that like to script instead of to click. Who here is a Windows admin or consultant or? One? Two? Wow. Okay. Well, I found out in the Netherlands that most Windows admins have been a little bit spoiled over the last 20 years. They can click everything. And basically, if you figure out how a GUI works, then you can accomplish any task in Microsoft-oriented programs. scripting takes a little bit different mindset. And with that in mind, also Microsoft is telling that the adoption of PowerShell worldwide is not what they expected. They expected it to be bigger. They're working on it to make people embrace it, but people don't like to be made do stuff. They want to do stuff if they want to. You can't force them. So the content, tips and tricks, and a case from the field. And this is almost all my slides. So this is a PowerShell session, not PowerPoint. Let's start with the basics. The execution policy. Every single beginner in PowerShell encounters this. The execution policy basically verifies that the script that is being executed, is it signed by a certificate authority that I trust? That's it. If you think, hey, this is an awesome security feature. No, it ain't. Really, no, it ain't. There are 15 documented ways by design to bypass the security policy. The execution policy, sorry. So it is just a verification of, I'm running a script here on production from a source code repository that I trust. Is this script still compliant, or has one of my colleagues touched the script and not re-signed it? Because if I sign it with my certificate, it is my ass on the line if the script fails and, let's say, removes the entire DNS infrastructure. And I see somebody laughing, but that actually happened one time. So. If you're working with hexadecimal numbers, if you put 0x in front of it, you can convert the hexadecimal to a decimal. Easy peasy. I see developers loading classes and stuff like that to do this. And it's pretty easy, actually. So, CD. In the Windows world, if you CD to a directory, etc., then you get to the directory and blah, blah. With PowerShell, you have a set location, but you also have a push and a pop location. Using push location, it basically builds a stack of where you went in the past. So if I go to the PowerShell test generator, after that through push location to the PSOCD and then to the WSDL directory, and I do pop location, it goes back one. So if you have a script that provisions, for example, home directories or whatever, then if you have an error, you don't have to figure out what is my current location, do I have to go back up one level or down one level. By using push and pop location, you can just basically put the logic in there instead of figuring out where you are at that time. Pretty useful. PS script root is a variable that is basically empty, unless you're in a script. PS script root basically tells you where is the script located that I'm currently running. So the relative path. This one I use a lot on blog articles. There is a function in PowerShell named prompt, and you can override it. That's how, for example, Git for Windows does it. They add to the PowerShell prompt, and if you go inside a Git repository locally, then it changes the prompt like, hey, how many commits are there to be pushed, etc. You see that by numbers and colors. You can also change the prompt to whatever you want. So in the past, there were a few MVPs that, because of we were MVP, Microsoft tells us information pretty far in advance. These days, we get it like 2 days earlier than you. That's it. But in the past, it was like 2 months earlier. So a lot of us were writing blog posts and creating screenshots and articles and posting it on our blogs the moment the information was released. And then you go to bed, you wake up, and for example, somebody in Vietnam took your blog post, put it through a translator, posted it on their own blog, and they were like, hey, look what awesome thing I've done. There were quite a few people annoyed by that. You're basically stealing our hard work. And we're posting it on a blog free for you to read, but not free for you to steal. So a lot of us were starting with, if we created pictures, put a watermark in front of it. Or if you were creating a screenshot of a PowerShell prompt, make sure that, for example, your name or your company name is in there. If you are still stealing my blog post, including the pictures, thank you. I would love that. Because you're translating my stuff to Russian, and you're keeping my company name in there. Thank you. Free marketing. Splatting. Splatting is a really, really basic PowerShell skill. If you have a command with multiple parameters and then you have to scroll to the right to read it, you're either zoomed in too much, zoomed out too little, or you have way too much parameters. So there's a solution for that. You can create a hash table, dictionary basically. This is the key, this is the value. And by putting the hash table after the command name, here you define a variable by using the dollar sign, and here you put it behind the command name with an at. This is splatting. And what it does is this. The command still works, it redirects the output of a start process to a file. It's basically doing exactly what I'm doing here. But now in the script you don't have to scroll to the right to read it. Splatting is all about readability, not about speed or anything like that. PowerShell drives. That has been in PowerShell like forever. And you have, these days you have a SQL drive, for example. Well, let's say that you have a basically PowerShell environment. You go to the C drive, to the D drive. You go to the certificate store locally in Windows. My certificates. So you can handle a certificate store just like a directory if you want to. You can do new item and just as you would create a file, create a new certificate. With the content is the thumbprint and the name is the subject, for example, or the other way around. Always forget that. On the other hand, HKLM, the registry. So what I'm going to do here is start this PowerShell elevated. HQLM, software, and display link is the first D. And after that we got Docker. So if I do md devops this wet, that's new. Oh, cd software, and if I refresh, DevOps days. So this way you can browse any registry you want, just as you would any directory or any file or Kubernetes drive. So you also have a PS drive for SQL and for SCCM and for almost any product. And the community has been pretty smart, because the implementation of PS drives is really, really, really slow. And it can be so much better. That's what the community said. Then they came out with SHIPS, S-H-I-P-S, which is basically a different implementation of achieving the same goal. If you have a SIM repository, you can generate a SHIPS-based drive and browse it through, like just as you've seen, over basically WSMan. So in case you don't know what WSMan is, who doesn't know what WSMan is? Okay. WSMan is basically the protocol for SIM. You can configure it through HTTPS, so securely, with certificates, with thumbprints, with whatever. SIM is the replacement for Microsoft's WMI. WMI is not firewall friendly. You can't route it through the network whatsoever. It is kind of legacy technology. And SIM, on the other hand, can be routed, can be secured, etc. And in case you are like, hey, what is this SIM thing? Google. There is a thing called DMTF, Distributed Management Task Force. Let's take a look if we can get a picture. Yeah, sure. Open Standard Protocols. The beauty about open standards is, if you use it, you can talk to a system, like a repository, in a single way. And if a different vendor comes with a different kind of repository, and they also use the same standard to talk to it, all you have to do is create your commands and say, hey, I want to talk to this repository or this one. There's no different kind of interface there. DMTF, Microsoft is in there, Cisco is in there, it's like all major players are there. Intel, Smash is for server hardware, etc. Pretty neat. The big players actually working together for a change. String formatting. There are many different ways, with single quotes, double quotes. Single quote basically means literally what's in between these quotes. A double quote means, hey, if there's a variable in there, try to interpret that and convert it to a string. Like, show it as text. PowerShell has a lot of intelligence in there trying to help you. Like, if you're trying to do something and the only logical thing you would want to do there is like ABC, but you're not doing it entirely syntax correctly, then PowerShell will try to do it for you. So basically, if it quacks like a duck, if it talks like a duck, if it walks like a duck, we're going to handle it like a duck. is you fill a variable. How many times do you see in a script where you can fill a variable and then you call the variable to see what's in there? There's a different way for that in PowerShell. You put parentheses around it. Now you fill the variable and show the content to the screen. Some commandlets and functions have a don't have default output. Like, you run them and nothing is shown. Like set user, for example. You run it and if you don't get an error, it went all right. If you get an error, there something went wrong. Pretty annoying. So a lot of those, if that's the case, many of those commandlets have a pass through parameter, which basically means show me what's going on, show me output. String formatting, pretty straightforward. You have a string. If you do too upper or too lower, it all the letters in there are converted to uppercase or to lowercase. However, there is a thing called title casing. Who knows what title casing does?
Capitalize the first letter for each word.
For each word, very important addition, yes. So now you can force, for example, if you're creating users, that each word needs to be with a capital. In some languages, there are still some quirks in there, like apostrophe T space H-O-F-F. It's a pretty common name in the Netherlands, and it will capitalize the T and the H, and the T shouldn't be. So there are still some quirks in there. Oh, and by the way, this is pretty well hidden. I found this just by doing something completely different. Because not every language has a concept of title casing. There are languages where the uppercase just doesn't exist at all. This one I'm skipping. Oh, yeah, this one's pretty useful. Hash tables. If you have a hash table, create one. Most people add to it by using, this is calling Netherlands capital Amsterdam. But in Germany, in England, what are those capitals? Oh. Good morning. This is not allowed this way. However, if you do it this way, it is allowed. Different syntax can be very useful. This is annoying. I'm actually going to show this in here. What is 1 plus 1? Any takers? 2. Okay. What's this?
2?
Who said 2? Who doesn't think 2? Well, you're wrong. It's 2. What's this?
11.
Correct. The first character in the equation, if it is a string, defines the behavior of this pipeline. So So like I said, PowerShell will try to help you. If you're doing this, it will think, well, one plus a string. And I can convert this string into an integer. Well, if that's what you want, I'm going to do it for you. However, if you start with the string, it will think like, hey, you have a string and you want something added to this string. So 11. Actually, what happens here is that, let's do it this way. It's an integer. It's a string. So it doesn't become 11, it becomes 11. Small detail. If you do something like this wrong in, let's say, banking, then that can be beneficial for your customers or not. Either way, somebody will not be happy. Yeah. A long time ago, I wrote a blog post using PowerShell, or better yet, console and beep. I'm actually going to put my audio on the loudest possible. And this is HDMI, so perhaps it won't run. Mr. Tech Guy, if I yank this HDMI out, will your recording fail? No means yes, okay. What happens is this. Again. So that's for the people that don't recognize it, it's the Imperial March from Star Wars. So I wrote that in like half an hour, just figuring out the tones. I posted this on my blog, like Mission Impossible, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, like that one. I can't whistle. But 2 days later, somebody else replied with a comment on my blog. Hey, here is the entire Imperial March. That was like huge. I don't know how much time he had to spare, but apparently a lot. The reason how I came up with that is when I was in an internship, I did it at a high school. I created a logon script that used beep and songs. And based on the song, the teacher or student was able to recognize, hey, is my printer mapping going wrong, or my network mapping, or whatever. That went on beautifully for a few weeks until we had a really bad network disruption. And then the teachers were getting crazy about all the songs playing in through each other every time a class started. They didn't like that a lot. So my manager then made priority for me to change the logon script before fixing the actual problems, because teachers were annoyed. Don't name your variable error. Come on. Why shouldn't you do this? Pretty straightforward. PowerShell has a few errors natively. Variables natively. Amongst them is error. If I generate an error, you will see it's filled now with the errors. So if you try to overwrite the error variable, you get an error stating, hey, you're not allowed to. The system is, but you're not. So naming your error variable error is pretty logic. But that's also what the PowerShell team was thinking, and they did it already, sorry. So name it something like my error, script error, whatever. Just not error. This is a tip I put in there specifically because I had it multiple times with different customers where they did this. So right now I'm going to show you how I became a PowerShell master in under 24 hours. I had a manager who had a tendency to walk around the office. And I was the main scripting guy there, and he was literally telling me, yeah, I've been a programmer. The more errors I see on your screen, the worse you are at your job. The problem is I learn from my errors. If I run a 20-line script, I run it one time, and there are no errors there, I'm checking if everything went correctly because I don't trust this. So, he literally told me, the more errors, red text, I see on your screen, the worse you are at your job. Hey, no problem. We can work with that. If you want to be stupid, master. So, easy peasy. Start process dot. First of all, Windows 10, they added this little thing. Open Windows PowerShell or Windows PowerShell Elevated, Zebin. In this directory. So if I do this, you'll see that I'm currently in that directory. Right now, I'm here. If I do start process dot start dot invoke expression dot or II, which is an alias for invoke expression dot, you'd get the other way around. So, practical little thing. I work a lot in PowerShell, and every now and then I want to check in the Windows Explorer. And what I did in the past was go to the prompt, copy paste the entire path, go to Explorer, paste it in there, etc. Yeah, that's like really bad. You know why? I did it in Windows Vista, in Windows 7, in Windows 8, I believe. Yeah, at least Vista and 7. So, the last time there was a TechEd in Europe, it was in Barcelona. And everybody knows Mark Krzyzewicz, he's from Microsoft. Sure. Like SysInternals, the little nifty little tools, you saw. He was showing, a little background, 10,000 people in the room, 400 people are journalists, everybody else is a developer or a techie. IT pro, but technology related. Krzyzewicz was showing 1 million IOPS in a virtual machine on Azure. Like, wow. And all the techies were like, yeah, but I see what you did there. That's like really costly. That I can do that with that setup. But all the journalists was a standing ovation, like, wow. And okay, a few minutes later, Mark Krzyzewicz did this. Click, drag, Control C, Control V. You're quiet, but this has only been possible for about 2 years, maybe three. In Windows XP, in Windows Vista, in Windows 7, this was not possible. you had to do right, you have to do right click, select mark, mark what you want to do, right click again, don't control C because that will mess things up, and then it is in your copy paste. So you have the PowerShell team to thank for this. They added this in PowerShell.exe, and then Jeffrey Snover, the thinker, the founder of PowerShell, he was like, wait a second, this is a pretty good addition. Let's remove it from PowerShell.exe and implement it in conhost.exe, which basically means every single console on Windows derived from conhost.exe has this benefit. So also bash on Windows, for example. Useful. Oh, by the way, 400 journalists sitting down, the other 10,000 people, standing ovation. Yahoo, finally! We were asking for this for 15 years already. Skipping that one. Yep. These are aliases. What does this little line do? Well, the answer is underneath, but yep, not much. This is what it would have done, in theory, if I had not added the what if parameter. This would cause a blue screen of death. But if there's any command that may be dangerous, most of them have a what if parameter, just to see what would this command have done. It emulates within the context of this command. So it is not asking the system, hey, do I have the required permissions to kill this process? It's just simulating, I would have performed this action on this object. That's it. I'm over time? Damn it. I was already trying to go fast. Okay. Then the practical case I will not show, but I will share the code. And the last one is why you should not execute code where you don't understand what's going on. What does yeah, there's no audio then. Darn it. There's no audio, but I don't know if you recognize it, but it's basically the music video from Rick Astley. Never gonna give you up, no, that one. So, only execute code that you understand. And if it is 2,000 lines of code, take your time, read it. And if you don't understand it, do not execute it or ask somebody else. Whatever you do, test it first on a safe environment. So, I do have some questions, I guess.
Change home.
Yeah.
2 seconds. It's like jerk.
Quick basic. Like Q basic? Because I've done that in the past. That oh yeah. So my first ever programming experience was with QBasic in DOS, where I created my own Pac-Man because I wanted to learn. And it took me 2 weeks to figure out that if this variable and this variable have the same value, you're dead. And remember, I was 6. So give me some credit here. But creating a Pac-Man has been basically my exercise for most programming languages, from PHP to C Sharp to Pac-Man calculator. It will teach you the basics. And yeah, music, yeah, definitely. And thank you for attending.